is somebody we're glad to have here tonight. He's the author of This Book Will Not Be on the Test, and he will be selling them to those of you who are interested in the end. It will not surprise you to learn some of the things I'm about to tell you about this man. He has taught study skills to students from 105 different schools in the Washington metropolitan area. Prior to discovering study skills, he studied literature in Mexico City, backpacked from Spain to Syria, performed stand-up comedy, can't we see that, in Spanish, in Buenos Aires, and traveled from Argentina to the United States by bus. He has a BA in math, sociology, and Spanish from UC Santa Barbara, and an MA in teaching English to speakers of other languages from the New School. And we are so glad to have him here. This is Paul Rivas.
So if I mess something up, or if you can't hear, if I do it wrong, wave or something, okay? So I know. Thank you to Sue and Bridget and Andrea for organizing this. This stuff is a nightmare to organize. If you've ever done it, you know. If you haven't, this is like 50,000 emails we are looking at up here, right? Like, this stuff is a hassle. But I'm super happy to be here. And if you need something, shout. If you have a question, yell it out. Hopefully you brought your most challenging questions. This isn't school. You can do whatever you want here. There's just shout it out. We're going to talk about everything you could possibly want to know about how to learn more and do better in school efficiently so you have more time to do whatever you'd rather be doing. Can anyone think of something they'd rather do than homework? Okay, if you can't, then you don't need to be here. You're good. Go watch TV. If you can think of something, then okay, so you hopefully you're thinking more than one thing, because you're going to have so much extra time after this, you're going to just be like staring at the wall. All right, so what should you know about me? We're going to talk about study skills. My name's Paul. You call me Paul. I'm from California. I don't care about anything. I'm impossible to offend. Ask me anything, say anything, it doesn't matter, I promise. Just ask. Okay. So, how did I come to be here today? It's a long story, but basically, this is my fifth year in town, and I'm trying to teach anybody who's interested how to learn more efficiently so they have more time to go do cool stuff. Yeah? Okay, let's see if this works. Oh, the projector. All right. Yeah, thanks. Okay, so there I am. And then there's my sister. And then there's Barry the study dog. Who here is familiar with Barry the study dog? One or two of you, maybe? A couple of you? Yeah, okay. So those are pencils he's got. There's pencils over there on the table. I encourage you to take some home. The pencils will get you better grades in less time because they say better grades in less time on them. So when you use them, you're using the pencil and you're like, oh, I should be reviewing right now. Oh, I shouldn't be doing my homework with my phone in front of me. And you'll be reminded of everything we talk about and you'll get better grades in less time. Yeah? Okay. So use the pencils. I live here. I live in D.C., I teach study skills to anybody within striking distance or else on Skype. My sister lives like across the street from UCLA. And she's teaching stuff out there. And Barry is the muse. Yeah? So he's the subject of a lot of the photos of the weekly blog posts and stuff like that. All right. So many clickers. Okay, wrong one. It's working though. All right, so these are things you should be asking yourself right now, right? You should be wondering, why am I here? What's today, Tuesday? What's on TV tonight? No one knows, that's great. You guys are in the right place. Okay, you're all in the right place, okay? Don't watch TV. You're wondering what's going on. You might be wondering, who cares about learning? I'm doing fine, I have A's and B's. that's good enough. Surely I got my Xbox back. What do I need to learn for? Okay, you might be wondering that. You might be wondering, what if I do actually want to learn something, like how to catch flies with chopsticks? What do I do if I want to learn that? Well, here you'll learn how to actually learn anything you want to learn. And then you also might be wondering, once I know how to learn, what good is that going to do me immediately? And we'll talk about that. And then we'll talk about anything else you want to talk about. Things that are not study skills that I'm happy to talk about include how to write a book, right? So I wrote this book. It came out a month ago. Who here has thought of writing a book? Proudly. Raise your hand. Hi. Proudly. 1, 2, 3. Okay, 4, 5. Yeah. Okay, so if you want, I'll tell you how to write a book if you want. I'll tell you how. There's 3 ways. I'll tell you how to get it published. There's 3 ways for that, too. If you want to talk about study abroad in another country, we can talk about that. And if you want to talk about anything related to college, we can talk about that because I grew up at a college. All right. Okay, but really study skills, right? Okay. Ready to go. Okay, so why should you care what I'm on about? Has anyone ever heard of Steve Chu? So he's a professor at Samford University in Alabama, and he's the creator of these famous videos on how to study. They're really fun. You can Google them, how to study. You'll see this guy. So the stuff we're going to talk about, I didn't make this stuff up. I just like telling people about it because it's super fun, and it always works because it's science, right? So don't believe anything I tell you. Go Google it after this. But this stuff is science. I didn't make it up. All right. Anyone know Judy Woodruff? Yeah, she's a news lady. Okay. You guys don't watch TV, but you know Judy Woodruff somehow. Okay, something's amiss. All right. This stuff, the stuff we're going to work on, works for everybody. Everybody. Any grade, any school, any learning differences, any level of interest in anything, this stuff always works, I assure you. It'll work for you. It's worked for every kind of student in every kind of place all over this part of the world and all over the country. So there you go. All right, anyone ever heard of this dude? Yeah? He's the author of one of the most successful TED Talks ever about productivity. Which adults work will admit to working more than 55 hours per week? Any adults, any brave adults will admit to working more than 55 hours per week? This guy says that you shouldn't do that. I don't know if that's real, but he says that past 55 hours a week, you actually get less done. He also wrote a book about when you should do stuff. I don't know, some famous guy. He lives in D.C. His recent book was called When, about when to do things. So we'll talk about some of that. So the point is, who's going to go to college? Who's going to pay for somebody to go to college? Okay, if you're going to pay for college, you should be worried. Because college is super expensive now. And it's like literally impossible to put yourself through college like I did in 1997 through 2002. You can't do that anymore. You should be concerned. But don't worry, we're going to sort it all out. You'll feel so much better after you leave here. This is like The Matrix. Who's ever seen The Matrix? Okay, this is like The Matrix, what we're doing right now, I promise. You'll see. All right. Okay, questions so far? Comments, beefs, yeah.
Where's Barry?
Good question. Good question. Barry's at my house, but he's going to be at the Kensington Book Festival, Kensington, Maryland, Montgomery County, April 28, 11 to 4. He'll be there. You can feed him treats. But don't say treats. Say snacks. You say treats, he'll go mental. Right? He knows the word treats. You have to spell out the word snacks and if you want any chance to get away afterwards. Okay, anything else? All right, so we've been talking about why we're here. All right, now we know why we're here, because we're about to learn a bunch of stuff. Okay, sweet. Okay, so now, Why should you care? Who cares about learning? Like, surely, I mean, who's, if you're a student, raise your hand if your parents care about grades. Okay, why do you think they care about grades? Why would they care? Who cares? Yeah.
So you can get into better college.
So you can get into a better college? How do you know which colleges are good? I don't know. Yeah? Yeah. That's how you know which ones are hardest to get into for the people who apply. Yeah.
If you have better grades, you can apply for better jobs.
If you have better grades, people will give you better stuff. When you apply for jobs, mostly no one cares what your grades were. But when you're in school, the people that they give the sweet stuff to, those are the people with the good grades. All right, those are good reasons. Okay, so grades are stupid and arbitrary and ephemeral, and they evaporate after you go to the next level of school. So once you go to college, no one's going to care what your grades were in high school. It's not going to matter. Once you go to grad school, almost no one's going to care what your grades were in college unless you want to go be a doctor, in which case you need straight A's in college. Who wants to be a doctor? Anyway, if you want to be a doctor, you need straight A's in college. If you don't get them, you're not going to be a doctor, period. Sorry. That's how it works in this country. I didn't make the rules. Okay. What else? If you worry about grades, you will only ever learn as much as your teacher requires for you to get whatever grade you wanted, right? And that's not enough to pay rent in the cruel world, right? Really, you ought to be concerned about whether you learn the stuff, because after you leave school, the only thing you get to take with you is what you have in your huge brain. You don't get to go waving your grades around out in the world. No one cares, right? All you get to go take with you is what you have learned. So we're going for learning. Now, when I was talking about the Matrix earlier, you think that school goes from F. Do you guys have Fs out here in this district? Okay, you know, some school districts, they don't give you Fs, they give you E's. Have you heard of that? Yeah, isn't that silly? I mean, an F's an F. Okay, I don't know why they don't call it a G. So, you think school goes from F to A, but it doesn't. F to A, that's not what school is. School goes from F to learning, and learning is way over here. Okay, learning's like way down here. Okay, you don't have to learn to get A's. That's the problem, right? Students or adults, who has ever in your life got an A in something where you did not master the material? If you don't have your hand up, you're lying. Everybody ought to have their hand up. You got an A and you did not master the material. Who took French in high school? Boom, right? Okay, nah. Okay, grades are baloney. You need to go for learning. We're going to talk about how to actually learn stuff, okay? That's what we're here to do. Don't aim for grades. If you aim for grades, you only ever learn as much as the teacher requires for you to get that grade. If you aim for learning, you'll become awesome, and then you'll get whatever grades you want along the way. That's way better. Why else should you care about learning? I mean, really, I'm not convinced yet. I mean, okay. Why should you care about learning? Because college is expensive, right? Luckily, you're in Virginia. Phew. Okay. Think if you're in a state where there weren't so many attractive options for college, then what would you do, right? What if you lived in D.C., right? Then they would throw you, like, whatever, however much they give you in D.C., 10 or 14 grand or something, so you can go to college in some other state. That's not enough, right? Okay, so luckily you live in Virginia. You got that going for you. Okay, but college is expensive. What does it cost to be, how much does it cost to go to the movies now? Dude, yeah. Okay, yeah, so $20 Okay, how long is the movie? Yeah, okay, 2 to 3 hours. 3 hours if you can stand it, right? 2 to 3 hours, okay, for a movie for $20. How much does it cost? How much does it cost to go to college, at a college outside of Virginia or at a private college? Plus room and board, plus coming home to visit your family whom you miss so much, plus all these other stuff. If you go to a private college or a college out of the state of Virginia, it's going to cost you approximately $100 an hour to go to school. Every hour of school, $100. Okay? So now who wants to go to college? Now who wants to pay for college? Okay? So you got to, we're going to talk about this. All right. So college is expensive, and if you can learn how to learn now, then when you get to college, you'll have an awesome time and you'll get your money's worth. What do I mean? Well, if you can get better grades in less time than it's taking you right now to get whatever grades you have, then not only will people give you more stuff, but you'll have more time to do cool stuff that you'd rather be doing than homework. Right? So who here would be happy with straight A's? Okay, a few people, will cop to that. Good. Not everyone will admit to that, right? It doesn't matter what you want. But not everyone wants A's. Okay, if you could get straight A's in no time at all, 0 minutes a week, straight A's, boom, woo, straight A's, what would you do with all your extra time? You would chill. If you had extra time, you would chill. Who else would chill if they had extra time? Yeah, what else would you do?
Play video games.
Which ones?
Madden.
Madden. Attaboy. Yeah. Okay, are you going to be a football coach?
No.
No? Well, you don't know that. How do you know?
No.
I mean, if you get too good at it, you might not have a choice. Right? They might make you an offer you can't refuse. Right? What would you do if you could get straight A's in no time at all?
Read.
Read for fun? Yes, that's the best thing you can do. You win. Yeah, that's it. Okay? Reading for fun is the fastest way to get smarter, short of moving to another country, which you probably aren't going to do soon, not before you read another book. Okay? So reading for fun is the fastest way to get smarter. There are certain colleges that you literally cannot get into if you don't read for fun, such as Columbia. Who wants to go to the University of Columbia? Okay, so you can't go there unless you read a million books for fun, because they have a question on the application that says, tell us about all the books you read for fun in the last year. And if your list isn't a mile long, then guess what? They're saving you from yourself. You wouldn't be happy there, because there you have to read like 10 books that are 1,000 years old, that are 500 pages, and then take a huge test twice a year. That's how it works. Yeah. So read for fun. Keep reading for fun. That's the best thing you can do. So read for fun, video games, chill, play, work on sports, make cool stuff, whatever you're into. All right. That's what we're all aiming for. What time is it now? Thanks. Okay. All right. So we talked about why you should care about learning. Why not just get straight A's? I mean, whatever. After all, straight A's, you don't have to do as many chores, right? Why didn't I just stop at straight A's? Well, so now we're going to talk about how to actually learn. All right, so you can look at this. So intelligence is overrated, right? Being smart and a dollar will get you a Coke, okay? Being smart and a dollar will get you a Coke. Okay? All right. So that's that. Don't highlight until you're decorating your study guide. You don't pull out your highlighters until your awesome study guide is super duper made, and now you just want to decorate it and organize it to make it easier to use. Then you can use highlighters. Don't use highlighters until then. Right? Because when you take notes, the problem with taking notes is that when you take the notes, you're dumb. And you're like, oh man, I didn't know that, I better write write that down, okay? Woo, I wrote it down. Okay, and then like a week later, you heard that thing like 50 times, and now you know it super duper well. Or sometimes you take notes and you write something and you think it's super important, and you're like, oh man, that's so important, I'm gonna write that down. And then you get home and you look at it, and you're like, what the heck did I even write? This isn't even useful, right? So don't use highlighters. If you highlight something that you think is important and it turns out not to be important, then you have a bright pink reminder of how dumb you were a week ago when you review your notes on the weekend, and that's not good, right? So highlighters are the devil. Don't use them. Until it comes to color coding, that's fine. Color coding is helpful. Colors are good. But highlighting is passive and dumb, don't it? Really, what you should be doing is this one, talking about what the heck is happening in the book while you're reading it. Why should you do that? What's the point? Why? What good will that do you? Why should, yeah. Okay, and what happens if you don't know the main idea? Who cares? You can't really explain anything, right? So that's a really good answer. That's a smart kid's answer. My answer would be so that you don't space out while you read it. Who has ever spaced out while reading something? Yeah, you're like, you're reading, and you're like, they're like, read these 10 pages. You're like, woo, 6, 7, 8, page 8, and then in came Johnny. You're like, what, Johnny? Who's Johnny, right? And you're like, flipping back, Johnny came in, page 2. Okay, now you have to start all over. That's why you have to tell yourself what's going on. You have to check in with yourself as often as you don't want to have to reread this stuff, right? So if you don't want to have to reread 2 pages, then every 2 pages you have to tell yourself, remind yourself of what the heck's going on so that you know that you're getting it. Yeah? By the way, anything that's on the screen, don't write it. We're going to send it to you. Yeah? Anything else? Just pay attention. If you want to write some stuff down at the end, that'll work too. You don't take notes when you go to the movies, do you? You pay $20, you don't even take notes? No, but somehow you remember all the fun parts. Yeah, how do you do that? Okay, yeah, I mean, I don't know. What's the difference between school and the movies? Yeah, that's I agree. Yeah, that's a good, I agree with you. He said it's not, there's no difference, it's just different stuff. You don't get to learn about Spider-Man that much in school. Yeah, I agree. That's a good remark. All right, so then what else about learning? Okay, so let's say that you were born and you were super smart when you were born. You came out and you were just super smart and everyone was happy for you. And then you got real comfortable being smart, and you preferred to be smart than not be smart. So you became reluctant to do stuff that would make you feel dumb. If you did that for long enough, you would end up dumb. Because the money is in doing stuff that you don't know quite how to do yet and discovering what you did wrong and then doing it better the next time. Right? Like, who plays basketball here? Okay. You in the orange. How's your left hand, basketball-wise? Oh, you are? You with the other one. How's your right hand? Pretty good. Right, not the greatest. Not the greatest, but pretty good means terrible, right? It's terrible. Work on your right hand, right? You have to work on the stuff that's hard. That's how you get smarter. Nobody is born smart enough that they can't risk getting as smart as possible, right? So that's what we're headed for here, yeah? All right, so what do you think about number 4? Circling, yeah? But just me playing a tape of telling you the important stuff? So, yeah, would it be helpful to circle stuff in the book? Yeah, but then you'd have to go look in the book. Yeah? Take an informal quiz? What the heck is that? Yeah, I agree with you, but what is that? Like, informal quiz, you can't get those at 7-Eleven. What does that even mean? You could totally do that. Who's a teacher? No teachers in the room? Okay, all right, so there's no teachers. You could ask your teacher to do a bunch of free work for you that they weren't going to get paid for. You could totally do that. And if you were a really inspiring student, they would do it with a smile. But they might have to go to their second job, or they might be super tired, or they might have to grade 30 other kids' essays. I don't know. Being a teacher is a super hard job. You could totally do that. Now, what could you do if your teacher was, what if your teacher was sick that day? Your teacher's not available. You have a sub. What could you do? Yeah, you could Google, like, what is this stuff about, right? You could read the Wikipedia page. That would be super good, right? I agree with you. That's a pretty good answer. What informal quiz, but the Wikipedia stuff is not going to be on the test. What's going to be on the test? Yeah. That's an excellent distinction. So he said that the stuff that will be on the test is the stuff that the teacher's been emphasizing the last however many weeks, right? How often do you have a test here on Earth in a certain subject? Like every 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 1 week, something, two-ish weeks, more or less. All right, so an informal quiz, that's what you're supposed to do. That's what this all revolves around. But what does that mean? That means making an awesome study guide with all the important stuff that's going to be on the test and covering it up and quizzing yourself on what the answers are that you've covered up. It's not making a beautiful study guide in 8 colors and reading it to yourself 20 times while you listen to music and text your friends. That's nothing. That's worse than useless. It's put all the important stuff on a page, organize it so that you can cover up half of it and quiz yourself, and do that weekly until you know that you're going to get 100. That's what learning is. That's how you, okay, so there's no such thing as studying. Studying is what people do at Starbucks. There's no such thing as studying. There's only homework. There's homework that your teachers give you, and there's homework that you assign yourself. So if you want better grades in less time, you got to assign yourself useful homework. And the most useful homework is review every class every week, pick out the important stuff, write it in a study guide, quiz yourself until you know it. We'll talk more about that. All right, so, okay, here's the hard part, okay. There's no such thing as learning styles. Sorry, there's no such thing as learning styles. Learning styles are bogus, they're a scam. It was the wrong idea that someone had. It's in every school, every teacher, most kids. It's all a scam, there's no such thing as learning styles. The most important thing when you're trying to learn something is what you already know about it. For example, yes? Because someone's making a bunch of money. Same reason that textbooks are this thick instead of this thick. It's a scam. It's not real. If learning styles were real, then only kinesthetic learners could manage to drive a car. And they would all have to do their math on an abacus. But that's not the case. Anybody can learn anything, and everybody learns in every style. And if you think that you're a visual learner, you're wrong. You just like watching movies. That's not the same. That doesn't mean that if you didn't work your butt off at the other stuff, you wouldn't get better. You would. So now you're free. You're free from this false prison. There's no such thing as learning styles. Everyone knows this now. This is science. You can Google this. Remember, I didn't make this stuff up. I'm just the guy, right? Who has ever run a half marathon? Yeah, lots of, yes, great. What do you do the night before the half marathon workout-wise? What's the program?
Eat pasta.
Eat pasta. How much do you run? What, you don't go run at 9 at night, the night before the race? No, right? Not if you want it to go well. Okay, so what are you supposed to do the night before a test? You're supposed to chill, okay? If you have to study the night before the test, it's because you've been messing up the last 3 weeks, right? Who's ever been in a school play? Okay, the night before the play, are you up until 10 memorizing your lines? Hopefully not, right? Okay, so you're supposed to learn everything gradually, spread it out over as much time as you have. Here in school, in this country, you have like 2 or 3 weeks. So that means everything you have to learn, you have to spread it out over those 2 or 3 weeks. So you got to review every class every weekend, pick out the good stuff, put it in a study guide, quiz yourself. Okay? We're going to keep saying this. Right? That's the only way to learn anything. All right. Oh, yeah, and right brain, left brain, that's bogus, too. All right. Okay. So we talked about why you should try to learn stuff, and we talked about how you can actually learn stuff. So now we're going to talk about how to actually go out and get better grades in less time, right? Because this is totally doable. I wouldn't be here. All right. This is my wife. That's a grad school picture. She went to GW for public policy. That's why we moved here 5 years ago. She could do public policy. She works at GAO. Who knows what GAO is? Yay! Who works at GAO? Oh, all right. 1 million people work there. Okay, so how do you get better grades? Okay, this is how you get better grades. You plan to do your work at a time of day when your brain has half a chance of doing a good job for you. What else? You review every class every weekend when you have nothing to do before your friends want to hang out with you. But after you've slept in and eaten your 6-course breakfast that you made yourself after emptying the dishwasher and feeding the pets and dusting and vacuuming your room and your sister's room and changing all the sheets and towels, which is what I had to do every weekend back in Santa Barbara. And then you're going to keep track of everything and see where you're messing up and where you're kicking butt and try to go kick more butt. That's how you do it. All right, we're going to show you how. Okay, so now we're getting to the part where we're actually learning stuff. Okay? So all this stuff, you're going to print these. You're going to print these from my website, smithravis.com/motivation. You're going to print them. They'll also be in the, presentation slides. All right. So the school day is long and grueling, true or false?
True.
True.
Sort of.
Yeah, true, just ranging from sort of to true. Right, okay. When you get home from school, or whatever you do immediately after school, you're tired and hungry and you have to use the bathroom. True or false? Okay. After that moment, when you take care of everything, you're getting dumber by the minute until you wake up smart again the next day. True! Yeah, right? Okay, yeah. So, when should you do your homework? Yeah, like as soon as possible after a protein-filled snack, right? Almonds or beef jerky or whatever, or sand or whatever you're into if you're vegan, yeah. Almonds or beef jerky. Protein makes you smarter when you're tired. So as soon as possible after snack, and which homework should you do first? Yeah, you. Oh my gosh, you're so smart. Yes, do the hardest stuff first. Now, which homework do you usually do first?
Hardest.
No, come on. No, you're lying. No, you do the cake stuff, right? You do the you put off the hard stuff, and you wait till you do it after dinner when all your blood is in your stomach and not your brain, and other people are doing other things, and you're thinking that looks kind of fun. Maybe I should be doing that, right? Okay, so. First rule of, like, regular homework stuff is minimize after-dinner homework. Yeah? Minimize after-dinner homework. Now, what if you play sports and you don't get home until dinner time and then you have to eat dinner and you're super hungry? Well, then it's going to be hard. You signed up for it, hopefully. And if you play sports, you might be tough, so maybe you can handle it. But you should know that it's going to be way harder than it would be if you got to come home and chill for 15 minutes and play on your phone and eat a snack and then start your homework. But sports are pretty important, so I'm not saying don't play sports. I'm just saying you should know that that's why it's hard. Yeah? All right. So when's dinner in your house? Everyone shout the time. When's dinner? 6:30, 7, whenever we're hungry, whenever my mom gets home, something like that, right? You can be productive after dinner. You can get a lot of cool stuff done, but you don't want to be doing homework after dinner. You could be maybe practicing your second instrument. You could be reading for fun. You can be watching TV that will make you smarter. Don't watch dumb TV, but some TVs are right. You could be building stuff. You could be planning for how to sell stuff. You could be Googling stuff. Whatever. But you don't want to be doing homework. Yeah? All right. So now, when you get to school, what time, students, what time, when you get to school, like, how long does it take before you feel like your brain is working? 10 a.m.? Okay, yeah. 6:30. When 6:30, you're like, woo, let's go, yeah. Okay, that's good. So when you get to school, 8, like you get to school, you're like, all right, I'm ready, I can learn some stuff. Okay, that's when you're super smart. And basically your brain power is like dropping like a rock, and it drops faster after you eat lunch. Unless you have a really like restorative lunch, then maybe, I mean, it's pretty hard. Like basically, you're getting dumber by the minute from the minute you wake up. So when is the best time in the week to learn stuff? When are you awake and your brain is working, but you don't have anywhere to be, so you have time and you're comfortable and you can learn whatever you want to learn? When is that time of the week? Yeah.
The weekend?
The weekend, yeah. What time? What time do you like to get up on the weekend?
Like 12 o'clock.
12 o'clock, sweet. Perfect. That's a good answer. So after you get up at 12 o'clock, how long do you want to like go fart around until you're happy to go do an hour of schoolwork? Like an hour? Is that enough? An hour enough? Like you could eat breakfast, you could, you know, I don't know, watch He-Man, and then like be ready to do schoolwork. All right. So that's a great answer. So, and when you hang out with your friends on the weekends, when they want to hang out with you or go to the movies or do whatever, what time does that start? I couldn't hear you, sorry. Yeah, like 3 or 4 or something? Yeah. So you totally have time to do an hour or two of schoolwork Sundays or Saturdays at 1 p.m. and nobody would ever be the wiser except you. You figured it out. Good job. Yeah. So weekend mornings, before you have to go hang out with your friends, after you've slept in and did all your chores and made yourself a 6-course breakfast, that's the best time to learn stuff. That's the only time to learn stuff. Everything else is just like treading water, right? If you want to learn anything or make sure you learned it, you got to quiz yourself on what the heck happened in school that week, review everything you did that week, pick out the good stuff, write it down in a way that's visually pleasing and convenient for quizzing yourself, and then go to town with the quizzing. Yeah? So those hours, weekend morning hours, are worth way more than weekday evening hours. Like, so I have to cruise around teaching this stuff to people one at a time, at their house mostly, sometimes at their school, and I will not go to someone's house after dinner. That would never work, right? No supplemental academic help is ever going to work after dinner. It's not going to. How could it possibly, right? No adult does their hardest work tasks on which their mortgage or rent depends after dinner, do they? Nah, hopefully not, right? So figure out what the minimum amount of schoolwork you can do weekday afternoons, never on Fridays. Don't do schoolwork on Fridays. Kids, woo! Right? Don't do schoolwork on Fridays. Okay? If someone told you to do homework Friday afternoon, they're wrong. Right? Your brain is mush. The school day is long and grueling. 5 of those days in a row, your brain's not working. Don't do schoolwork Friday after school. When you hear about kids getting in trouble for doing dumb stuff, what night is it always?
Friday.
Yeah, because their brains aren't working, right? Yeah, don't do stuff Friday nights. No, just go read for fun or hang out with your friends or just go be a good person. But don't do homework. All right, so the way you use this thing is you make a list. Oh, no, print color. You make a list up here of everything in your life that takes time. Everything that takes 15 minutes or more. What are those things? Shout them out.
Soccer.
Piano.
Football.
Homework.
Fortnite.
Fortnite. Yeah. I mean, if you're trying to get better. Right? Fortnite, chores, yeah?
Reading
for fun, school, homework, transportation, Hebrew, what else? I don't know. Church or similar, lessons, appointments, practice, clubs, rehearsal,
sleep.
Food, naps, which are different from sleep, being a good person in your family, babysitting, what else?
Fun.
Chilling, fun. Fun's different from chilling, right? Chilling and fun. Sometimes you're too tired to have fun, but you're not sleepy, and you just have to chill. Yes? Dancing, yeah, totally. Dancing, yes?
Playing with your imagination until you sleep.
Yeah, right? But don't let it slip into ruminating. Ruminating's bad, right? Thinking is good, right? Yeah, totally. All right, so you list all the things you have to do. Then you mark them all on the calendar. You put them all in. School looks like this. School, wake up, bus, walk, whatever. Practice, rehearsal, take the bus home, chill, walk the dog, homework somewhere in here, dinner somewhere down here, reading for fun, doing cool stuff down here. What do you know about the importance of sleep? Yeah?
The more you sleep, the more you'll be able to learn.
Yeah, so if you don't sleep enough, what's that do to your brain? Yeah, it makes you dumb. Okay, what do you look like if you don't sleep, if you didn't get a good night's sleep? How does your face look?
Miserable, terrible.
Yeah, you look ugly. So if you don't sleep enough, what do you get? dumb and ugly. That's it. That's how. Who thinks their teenager doesn't sleep enough? That's how you convince teenagers to sleep more. You just ask them just what we just did. That's what you do. And every teenager will respond to that. Everyone, right? None of us is so confident that we can risk just signing up to become dumber and uglier, right? All right, so get lots of sleep. Do your schoolwork when you have a half a chance of doing a good job. And chill when you're supposed to chill, right? Who's going to be in 11th grade someday? Oh, my gosh. 11th grade is the busiest year of every American's life, right? Like, 11th graders are busier than any adult working, you know, less than 70 hours a week. So, I mean, that's mental, right? Right. Okay. So this one is where you keep track of, like, all the basic stuff. You figure out what you want your life to look like. And if you don't like how your life looks, then you move the pieces around and you make it seem funner, right? How much homework do you have? How much is a healthy amount of homework? Who knows somebody that has what they think is an unhealthy amount of homework? It's only the kids raising your hands. You guys, what are you doing? Okay, yeah, you. So describe that. What's that? What looks unhealthy to you? Yeah.
So it's like, come home, have a snack, catch your breath, and then get on with it. But we're looking at another hour and a half.
So how much homework is an impressive amount of homework? And you're what you've witnessed. Like, at what point does it become a problem?
When he's doing homework before dinner, and then he's got another couple hours after.
Yeah, okay. So anything before dinner and then another couple hours. That to me is, yeah, I super agree. Okay, so in my travels in the last 5 years, teaching this stuff to kids from 100 and something schools, my conclusion is that you can't do more than, if you're a high school student, you can't do more than 2 hours a night of homework on a school night and have a healthy life. I don't think that's possible. I think if you have more than that, then you're neglecting the real world or not getting enough sleep, one or the other. So I think the max for a high school kid is 14 hours a week in 7 2-hour chunks. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Never on Friday. And then anywhere from 1 to 3 2-hour chunks on the weekend, preferably 2 or 3 if you have that much, right? So basically, as much work as you can move to weekend mornings, the better. Your life will get way better if you can do more work weekend mornings. And you're going to say, but I don't have that much homework on the weekends. It's not about the homework they assign you. It's about the homework you assign yourself. If you can invest an hour or 2 or 3 or 4 on the weekend in reviewing everything and picking out the good stuff and making a great study guide, all your other homework will go faster. And you'll start to feel super smart in every class, and school will get super fun and super easy. And then you go do cool stuff. Okay, so that was like your regular life. Now we're going to talk about everything that would mess up your regular life, for good or bad. Yeah? So mess up is not necessarily bad, right? So, are we in the fourth quarter yet in this school year? Yeah, when did the fourth quarter start? Tuesday. This, last week? Okay, so this is what you do. You're going to print this thing out. And up here in this box, you write 4/1, because this is the week of April 1st. Down here, you write 4/8, and you go all the way down, and you're going to get down to, like, 6/17. This is the fourth quarter. Even 11th grade is not some big monster. 11th grade is 4 of these. Right? Anybody can keep it together for 11 weeks. This is like a half marathon training plan. Except the goal is not run a fast half marathon. The goal is get whatever grades you want in a healthy, happy way. So on this thing, you keep track of everything that's big that you can Everything that's big that you can schedule ahead of time that might cause you to have to kind of tweak your finely tuned weekly schedule. Like, what would cause changes to you? You have your weekly schedule, you're like, woo, I'm doing it, yeah. And then, boom, this thing happens and it messes you up. What kinds of things are those that you can plan ahead for? Doctor's appointments, yeah. That's totally one of the kinds of things. Yeah, what else? Big projects. Doctor's appointments. Mitzvahs. Projects. Essays. Tests. Quizzes. Road games. Tournaments. Competitions. Recitals. What else? That's stuff, holidays, family trips, sibling events. Those go in gold, right? Everyone loves going to their siblings' events. Over here, over the weekend, you're going to write in big letters, review. Review. Spell it however you want. You're going to write review. And then you're going to tell yourself which classes you're going to review on which days. You're going to decide, oh, I should review these four classes this weekend. Really, you should review every class every weekend. But you're going to say, but in this class, we don't really do anything. Well, then it won't take very long. Review every class every weekend, anywhere from 10 to 45 minutes. And you keep track of which classes you review on which days. So that when you get 100 on the test, you don't have to be surprised. You're like, oh, I reviewed this class every Saturday at 11. No wonder. Right? Let's say you want to go to Vegas spring quarter, fourth quarter. You can do that if you see it coming a mile away and you plan ahead and you move your weekend review to some other point in the week. Other than that, it's not going to go well. Right? Who plays sports in the spring? Yeah. So, in sports, what tends to happen is your biggest assignment is due the Monday after the farthest away tournament. And your hardest test is the morning of the afternoon of the funnest game. And all the playoffs happen during finals week. That's how it is in college anyway, right? So you got to see that coming a mile away, right? Remember, you signed up for this stuff. So figure out when you're going to get the work done and do it at the least painful time. Yeah? Because it's going to be hard. Learning's hard. So you have to do it at the most convenient time. Not convenient, that's bad. You have to do it at the most opportune time and you have to work really hard while you do it and drink lots of water. All right. So then, now we're at the part where we're keeping track of how all this stuff works. So, who has ever kept a to-do list? Everybody, right? Certainly every parent. Okay. How many columns on your to-do list, sir? Three. What are they? Oh, that's really ambitious of you. Okay, yeah. Well, you have to do what you want to do and then like a moonshot or something. That's a fun to-do list. Hey, stay with this guy. You'll be all right. That's pretty good. This to-do list has four columns. So it's 33% better than yours for math people. I was a math major. Okay, so this first column says stuff I have to do. Stuff I have to do, yeah? Okay, that's mostly where people's to-do list stop, right? Stuff I have to do. Yeah. All right, second column, how long I think it'll take. Third column, based on how long I think it'll take, the day and time that I should actually do it, and, you know, given what else I have going on in my awesome life on my quarter calendar, right? Oh, I have to do this stuff, but wait, I have to go to four parties today. Well, then, maybe I should have done it yesterday, right? Now we're learning, okay? And then, most importantly, and fair warning, don't do this unless you want to get better at everything. If you don't want to get better, don't do column four. Column four says how long it actually took and why. Well, who cares why? Well, we're trying to discover. We don't know. None of us knows anything. Not you, not me. We're all delusional, right? There's a lot of research about this. All humans are delusional. We think we know stuff. We lie to ourselves like mad about what we know. Everybody, every parent knows this, right? None of us knows anything. So if you're going to actually get 100% on everything in school, you have to figure out a way to know if you actually know it. And that's the hardest part. So that's what we're trying to do here. You think that your math homework takes you half an hour. Well, go try to do it with your phone in your hand and your headphones in your ear and see how long it takes. And then think about whether you want it to take less time next time. If you think that, let's say you hate math. You think your math is going to take you 45 minutes. Well, try to do it right after your nutritious snack. After you've been hanging out with a dog for 15 minutes and feeling good about your life and are ready to work hard for half an hour before you take 5 minutes off and see if you just don't get it done in half an hour. Right? So it doesn't matter how long stuff takes. Who cares? It doesn't matter. Everyone's a slow reader or whatever. It doesn't matter. What it matters a lot that you know how long it's going to take so that you can plan efficiently to get it done with a smile. Right? Who has ever gone to do errands with their parents, and their parents told them it would take 20 minutes, and it took like 3 hours. Okay, and how much did you hate your parents after that? Yeah, right? Okay, if they would have told you, suck it up, mate, it's going to be 3 hours, I'll give you snacks, you'd be like, all right, and you'd have been fine. But the fact that it took way longer than they told you it was going to, that's what makes it painful. So none of us knows anything. We're trying to figure out how long stuff takes. Figure out how long it takes to read 5 pages in the chemistry book. Figure out how long it takes to read 3 scenes in Romeo and Juliet and write good summaries. And then plan ahead for the next time. Yeah? All right. So then what? I don't know. Okay. What time is it?
8:04.
Sweet. Everything's working so good. Okay, what should you do next? You should print these things. The weekly schedule, everyone should do one, especially adults, right? If you do this and you don't fall out of your chair, call me and I'll give you $1. Adults should definitely do this, either with your kid in mind or with yourself in mind. Everyone should do the weekly schedule at least once. Figure out how much homework you have to do. And then assign it during their smartest hours and put as much on the weekend mornings as possible. If you want, you can do one every Sunday after dinner, but you don't have to. The quarter calendar, that's where you should be keeping track of which classes you review which weekend. If you resist using the quarter calendar, it means you're lying to yourself and you're not actually reviewing stuff every weekend. Nobody who's actually doing it would resist keeping track. So don't lie to yourself, right? The to-do list, you could use it for daily assignments. You could think about it on the bus, and then when you got home after snack, first thing you could do is list everything you have to do and take a wild guess at how long it'll take. You could totally do that. You could also use it for big projects. I, in my life cruising around Earth, I use it for big projects. But if I had a hard time keeping track of small projects, I would use it for every single little thing. So print a bunch of these on my website and use them. Yeah? What? Is that the wrong way? Yeah. Next thing you could do is if you put your email somewhere, I'll send you the monthly newsletter. And the monthly newsletter is highlights of what has been on my blog that month. Every Monday, I write a different thing. So first Monday is a timely study skills tip. Second Monday is one of my favorite colleagues. Third Monday is a book recommendation. And fourth Monday is some fun, useful thing. So you can read that stuff. And I've been doing this without fail since August. So there's like 30-something things on there. You can knock yourselves out. Yeah. Okay, then, after you do all that, if all your problems aren't solved, then go read the book. You can get the book on Amazon, or I have a few here. The book has, in foolproof detail, everything you need to do to get whatever grades you want. And it also has as many convincing stories as you could ever want for why you should bother. Okay. So now, please ask your hardest questions. Anything we did not discuss, what problems did we not solve? Any problem, we will solve it now. With a smile. Ready, go. Yes.
You provided some great time management tips and tools. Can you also speak a little bit more to sort of the mechanics of more efficient?
Yes.
So if kids have a humongous textbook and they've got, 2 hours to read a huge chunk of the information, in addition to, your tip of staying engaged and asking yourself how this is relevant for the picture, what other technical?
So the question is concerning how to actually learn stuff better, especially if you have a ton of work to do and perhaps can't physically get it all done. Last Monday I wrote about what to do when you can't read everything. Okay, so you're asking, so basically what the heck should you do? Okay, here's what you do. You have to preview everything you're going to learn before you go to class. So you have to spend 2 minutes for every class Googling whatever fun thing you're going to be talking about tomorrow and figure out why it's fun before you go. That's the first thing. Yeah? So first you have to get excited about what you're going to learn. If it doesn't look exciting to you, then you're not Googling hard enough. You have to figure out why the rest of the world thinks it's great. Right? Your job is not to be entertained. Your job is to understand why people love whatever thing they're making you learn. Okay? Then, in class, you got to pay as much attention as possible so that you don't have to write down very much. Because writing stuff down gets in the way of you paying attention. That's why no one takes notes at the movies. Or when they hang out with their favorite uncle. Right? Your uncle wouldn't hang out with you anymore. You're like, you little weirdo. What are you doing? Put my pencil away. So you preview the topic. You pay as much attention as possible. You show up to class with a question and a comment that you want to know the other people's opinions on. Because you're trying to learn stuff. Because grades are worth zero for paying rent, right? You need to learn stuff. So you're trying to show up with a question and a comment. You pay as much attention as possible, right? Keep track of the main stuff, the stuff that's going to be on the test. Your job in class is figure out what's going to be on the test. How do you do that? Same way you get stuff from your mom. How do you get kids? How do you get something from your mom? Ask when. You scheme for weeks, possibly years, and you figure out what they need to hear, in what tone, at what time of day, what day of the week, and how often they need to be reminded. And you unrelentingly figure out what they want. That's what you do. So it's just like, you ever play soccer? Basketball? Tennis? Swimming.
I have swam before.
Okay, so you're facing the shark. How do you know which way the shark is going to swim? I don't know, what way they're looking, what way they're leaning, which way their tail's flopping, what the other sharks are doing, what you've seen this shark do before. Your job in class is to figure out what your teacher wants and then give it to them on the test.
But how do they do that? I mean, I want some concrete things to give the kids. kids, you know.
If the teacher says it 50 times, it's going to be on the test. If the teacher makes you do it three ways, it's going to be on the test. If the teacher goes like this when they're talking, it's going to be on the test. That's it. Nothing else is ever going to be on the test. In this country, they don't put things on the test that the teacher didn't say. Because then there'd be 30 pissed off moms calling the teacher the next day about why their kid got an A-. Teachers don't have time for that. Right? So, if you do it 50 times, if you do it three ways, or if the teacher loves it, that's what's on the test. Yes?
How do you advise kids to break the tech habit with music and video?
Yeah.
So that they can actually focus on what they
Yeah.
Do.
So, I give them as many examples as I can. The question was, how do you advise kids to break their tech habit while they're trying to pump out schoolwork? The answer is firmly. Because if you can see your phone, where's my phone? Anybody? My phone is face down in a box under that tablecloth. Because if you can see your phone, it's distracting. So, music, you cannot listen to music while you do homework. That's science. You can't do it. You're lying to yourself. The only exception is if you can't function without music for homework, then it has to be music that's super familiar to you that has no words. But that's preferable for like grunt work. But really, no music. And no phone in sight or turned on. Your phone has to be buried in the backyard while you do your schoolwork. And when you do that, the schoolwork goes way faster. And then you have more time to go do whatever on your phone and then plus however much more. So, no phone, no music. How do you convince kids to do that? Well, you have to get them excited about all the things that they could be doing if they got their homework done more efficiently. And all the things they could do 10 years from now if they actually learn this stuff.
Reggie?
Reading for fun is critical. It's hard for some kids. It's boring for some kids. Do you have suggestions or strategies for how to help someone fall in love with reading? Or?
Yeah. So reading for fun is critical. It's the fastest way to get smarter. Consider, if you don't like, who's ever read, by now we know each other. You know I wouldn't lie to you. There is no such thing as a boring book. Disagree? What book?
When there's that dark and brutal darkness behind it,
okay, yeah. What do you say?
Wind in the Willow.
Wind in the Willows? What are you, nuts? You need to take that back. My English grandma gave me a home-recorded audiobook on cassette tapes in her British accent of Wind in the Willows, and I ate it up when I was 7. You're out of your mind. What are you going to say? Yeah, you. Anthem by Anthem. You guys are a tough crowd. Okay, there's no such thing as boring books. There's only books that you don't know why they're awesome. Okay, you think Wind in the Willows is boring, you didn't Google it far enough, right? You have to read the Wikipedia page for why this book is cool. You have to get excited about stuff. If you don't like reading, it's just that you haven't found enough books that are cool to you. And if you don't think the books are cool, it's because you haven't done enough Googling. So go read books about stuff that you want to know about. That's more fun. Read at a pleasant time, right? You can't do it as a chore. You have to do it for fun. It's just like cleaning the toilet, right? If you treat it as a chore, you tend to skip a week. But if you, take pride in the toilet, then you're getting it clean, right? I clean my toilets. I do all the cleaning in my house. And I have to have all sorts of kooky ways to talk myself into being pumped about it, right? Like dishes. Who thinks they're a procrastinator here? Okay, you're not. You guys, boom, cured. Okay, you're not a procrastinator. Real procrastinators don't show up to stuff. So, boom, there you go. You're not a procrastinator. Here's the thing about procrastinating. When you know how long it's going to take, you don't procrastinate. Like me with the dishes, okay? I wash the dishes every night, dirty dishes, in the sink, okay? My wife cooks at home every night because she's got all these eating restrictions and she's got to cook her own goofy food. So we're cooking all the time. So then I got to wash the dishes. I started looking at the clock to see how long it takes me to wash these dishes. I started paying attention, like as if I had a four-column to-do list, right? But I'm doing it in my head. And I start to see how long it takes. And I do this for months. And now I can point to you, I can go to your house and look at your sink of dirty dishes and tell you within a minute how long it's going to take me to wash those dishes and wipe down the counter, the part that kids always forget. So what good is that? What good is knowing how long stuff takes? Well, when it's 9:30 and there's a big ugly pile of dishes and I'm feeling like I don't want to wash it, but I know that it's going to take me twice as long if I let it get all crusty in the morning, if I know it's only going to take me 13 minutes, I'm far less likely to slack on washing those dishes. So keep track of how long stuff takes, and then you're not procrastinating. If you do that long enough, you'll find a half an hour in the evening when you're happy to sit down and read for fun.
Yeah?
If you don't have time, root for worse teams. Then you won't have to watch too many games. Yes?
Is there a particularly good or bad place to do your homework?
Yes. You're supposed to move around when you do your homework. This goes back to your question. We're going to keep going back to that question. That's really the driving question, the one you asked. You have to move around. So you can't always do your homework facing east at your kitchen table. You have to move around. You have to get different views, different stuff, different cues. You have to be comfortable doing your homework at any table. I prefer silence, but I think the most important thing is that you're comfortable. Your room or your bed is the worst place for sure, no matter what. Your room is probably second worst if you have anything fun in it. Really, you should, but you need several places. You need to vary where you do your work. So comfy chair to read, you know, one table for this, another table for that, but mix it up and do different stuff and move around as often as you take a break, which might be every 30 or 60 minutes or something. Definitely not in your room. Definitely not in your bed. Bed is for sleeping. Yes.
Summer.
Yeah. Everyone forgets everything. Well, it depends what they're trying to do the next year, right? Like, if you're going to take hard math, I would do all that hard math ahead of time in the summer. Read as much as possible. Depends how much power you have over the kid, right? Make them do as much as they don't know, as they're happy to do without knowing they're being slighted, right? I've had students who have to read for fun in the summer, certain stuff, certain amount of things of a certain quality. Summer's for getting ahead. Like, do math and read for fun. Those two things always pay off. If you have a lot of hardcore science ahead of you, make sure that you get 100 on every math test, or you're not going to be a scientist. No, math, algebra gets a bad rap, but algebra is the most important skill in school by a factor of a bazillion. Because if you can't do algebra, guess what? You get C's in chemistry, then you're not going to be a doctor. Period. So get ahead, do fun stuff, but not so much that it feels like school, right? You don't want it to feel like school. You want it to be like a healthy amount, lots of exercise, lots of being productive, lots of helping people, lots of getting smarter, lots of chilling. So that's 2 hours of everything, right? Summer before sixth grade, I had to type on a typewriter 2 full pages a day of exercises from the Smelly Typing Book from the Galita Library. I did that 2 pages a day all summer, and I got up to 20 words a minute before sixth grade. I thought I was a man. Right? I was like, woohoo, 20 words, right? You need to be able to type 60 words a minute or else your life is going to be unnecessarily hard. So typing, making stuff, Legos, applying to selective programs if you want to get crazy, like programs that not everyone's allowed to go do, like that you have to apply for. Some people like doing that. I went to summer school every summer of my life from kindergarten through age 21 because my mom beat it into me. No one does that. You could try. Don't matter. You'll be fine. What else? Yes.
What if you read too much?
For example, meaning like you neglect bathing, that would be a problem. You read for fun, you read what you want to read, and you don't read what they tell you to read, or you read too late at night, and then you're up, like, and then you're tired the next day. Yeah. So it's all fun and games until you wake up dumb, right? Then it's just fun. Remember what happens if you don't sleep enough. That's the first thing. Second thing is make sure no matter what amazing thing you do in the world, it's way less impressive if you don't have straight A's. To me, straight A's comes first. Straight A's are meaningless. Grades are stupid and arbitrary. It's not going to matter, right? But because of that, you might as well take the good grades, right? So you give everyone what they want. First rule of school, keep your teacher happy. You give everyone what they want, and then you go do your own stuff after dinner, and you do that as much as you want until you need to start chilling before you go to bed. You can't look at your phone within an hour of bedtime. That rots your brain, messes up your sleep. So you read as much as you want until an hour before bed, and then you start chilling. Let's go back to the question about how you actually do this stuff. So we talked about what to do in class. What about with the reading? You have to Google what you read before you read it. You have to mark up what you're reading, right? Okay, so let's find something here. Something with words. Okay, so here's what I do. I invented this third grade at college, Isla Vista. Okay, if it's important, what do you do? Underline. Underlining is too much work. You could underline 5 inches here if you're into that. Or you could make 1/4 inch line here. That means the same thing. Math people, that's 20 times faster. Okay? You say, so what? I say, wait till you're in humanities at Columbia. If it's important, you make a line, and then you write a note to yourself about why you marked it, preferably a fun note. If it's super important, what do you do? Yeah, 2 lines. Important. Super important. If it's super important and has a quote that you're definitely going to want to put in the essay that your teacher is definitely going to make you write in 3 weeks, then what do you do? No, that's too confusing. 2 lines and a star. And the star means there's a great quote living here. So then what do you do after every reading? You look back at your notes and you write yourself a little summary of what the heck you read. It doesn't matter how long the reading was, the summary is always 3 or 4 bullet points. Okay? Then you look to see if any of what you marked has stars, and if it does, then you open up your Google Doc on your cursed Chromebook that your stupid school makes you use, or MacBook or whatever, okay? You open up your Google Doc, and you type those quotes in there, and you put them in a reasonable order, anticipating the essay you're going to have to write in 3 weeks. Then the teacher hands you an essay and says, here, write about the themes in this book. And you're like, oh, that's cute. I knew we were going to have to do that, and I already have all the quotes. And then you have to organize everything on the weekends and put it in a study guide. So you have to figure out what's going to be on the test, what you have to know about what's going to be on the test, and then what your method is for proving to yourself that you actually know it and didn't just get 100. Yeah? Yeah, yeah, please.
So, because you're going to want to reflect on this, review it, log it, and do it to either prove that he's right or wrong, we encourage you, actually we beg you to just leave your name and email address. We don't collect them, we don't keep them. We'll email you a survey about tonight, and we'll make sure that he emails you his handouts. And we thank you all for coming. Please join me in thanking Paul Rivas.
Thank you, Paul.
Yeah, there's a couple of books. There's pencils. Get pencils. They'll get you better grades in less time. Thank you so much for this. This is really hard to do for you. For me, it's nothing but fun. But for you, on a school night, getting out here with or without kids is super hard to do. So thank you for getting out here. That was super fun. Ask me anything you want. I will not leave any question unanswered.
Thank you.
All right, ready to go.